You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Drug overdoses are now the leading cause of death among Americans under 50. The Centers for Disease Control attribute this to the rising toll opiate addiction is taking, something the Senate health care bill last week promised to address, or perhaps it didn't. For more on this, we're joined by Sam Quinones. He's the author of Dreamland, The True Tale of America's Opiate Epidemic. The Senate health care bill died last week, and you write that one of the reasons some Republicans didn't support it was because it didn't do enough to address the problem of opiate addiction in this country.
Well, I think it was notable the Republican senators who rebelled against this idea that had been so poorly conceived and in pretty much utter darkness were from states that are leading the country in opiate overdoses. You know, you have Utah, Mike Lee was one of them. You have West Virginia, Shelley Moore Capito was a senator there, along with Susan Collins from Maine. Maine's been badly, badly hit by this problem. And of course, Ohio, Rob Portman. These were the senators who were, I guess, early on saying, what are you doing here? Why are we doing this? So I thought a quote that I read in the LA Times from Shelley Moore Capito was very poignant. She said, I didn't come to Washington to hurt people. Mm-hmm. And I think that there was widespread belief that that's what this bill was doing. And I think that, frankly, a lot of the groundswell against this bill, I can't prove this. It's not based on a political science study or anything, but it does seem to me that a lot of what motivated people to get to let the Senate know that this was not acceptable were feeling that people needed more access to drug treatment, not less. That they needed, that this was a very serious problem, and that the Senate was doing its best to turn a blind eye to this problem. And so it was remarkable to me to watch, because initially I thought, okay, this is just going to go through. And then you saw the beginnings of a rebellion. And really it was the states where this problem is the worst that were leading that rebellion.
Is Obamacare, through Medicaid expansion, making it easier for people to seek treatment for drug addiction?
It is. It covers drug addiction for a lot of those people. It provides coverage that most folks never would have had. And you're talking about hundreds of thousands of people. I can't remember what the numbers are for Ohio, but that's a huge number just in Ohio alone, where John Kasich, the Republican governor, back in 2014, went around a Republican-controlled state legislature to simply ordain that they were going to expand Medicaid in that state. And I think a lot of people are very happy that he did. A lot of folks I talked to in Ohio seem to think that was a really good idea, particularly folks who have addicts in the family or on the street or, you know, somehow connected to people with addiction, because a lot of those folks were out of luck, and a lot of them had no insurance at all. And a lot of the folks who struggle with addiction, after a few years of that, have gone through all their resources and are really just don't have much at all. And so they are the ones who are most in need of this. It's the folks really who've been in addiction for a while. I think after a while, you just have gone through your even if you're well-to-do to begin with. Your parents have mortgaged the house or taken out college savings to pay for a stint in rehab, which maybe you then relapsed from. Relapse is a part of addiction. It's an unavoidable part of addiction, in fact. And so a lot of folks just need this. And in Ohio, you know, Kasich did that. Other states, I think 31 states have opted to expand, use Medicaid expansion. And I think in some areas, certainly it was because of this. I think in the areas where this is most intensely felt, a lot of those states I mentioned and some others found people very amenable to expanding Medicaid.
Medicaid expansion is done on a state-by-state case. Did Obamacare dictate specifically the kind of drug rehabilitation that could be used through Medicaid expansion, or does each state decide what kind of rehabilitation can be provided?
That's a good question. I'm not sure I know the answer to that. I think that each state has some flexibility as far as that goes. I know that in Ohio, for example, one thing that the state did was expand the number of doctors that could prescribe a Suboxone, expand the number of providers of Suboxone treatment. Suboxone is a pill that helps. It prevents overdoses. It doesn't prevent the highs yet, but it's a kind of a partial, what they call a partial agonist. Now that has expanded remarkably in Ohio. There are problems with that. There are problems with a lot of these things, but it's something. It's the beginnings, I think. And I think a lot of folks viewed the Senate bill and what was passed in the House as well, but certainly the Senate bill, as a complete retreat from that, honestly.
Yeah. I wouldn't put anything past the Republican Party. You write on your blog that Donald Trump did exceptionally well in counties where opiate addiction is rampant. Is it conceivable that the Republicans don't mind the opiate addiction because it's good for them?
No, I don't think that's true. No, I think that a lot of those senators, I was just in Washington, in fact, and a lot of those senators seem very, I think they seem concerned. And I think the reason they seem concerned, well, each senator could tell you his or her reason. But what you're finding now is that the way this epidemic is now different from what was as recently as 2 years ago when I was writing my book, Dreamland, is that people from below are being felt on this. When I was writing the book, and this was recently, 2013 or 14, things were very quiet. Nobody wanted to talk publicly about how their child was addicted or any of that stuff. There was a deafening silence all across the country, and because people were ashamed. You know, people say this epidemic is only getting attention now. It's only getting attention because it affects white people. And my response is, no, the opposite is true. This was silent. This problem was silent for more than a decade because it affected white people. White people are predominantly those affected by this. They did not want this known. They did not want to make it public when their child died. The obituaries were pure fabrications. My son died of a heart attack.
You know what's different? Now that white people are dying, we're talking treatment, not increased prison sentences, right?
That's certainly true. Yeah, that is certainly true. The other thing that's different about this epidemic is that, as opposed to, say, crack, which I also covered back when I was a young reporter in the town of Stockton, California, there's no doubt that the racial difference here is pronounced and very evident when you dig into this, research this and investigate it. The other thing that's very pronounced is the almost complete lack of public violence accompanying this problem. And so during the crack years, public violence was the crack epidemic. I mean, I covered drive-by shootings, the rise of the Bloods and the Crips in a town that never had these gangs before, carjackings, bullets whizzing through apartment buildings all across the country. This was the nature of the crack epidemic, and therefore, too, talked about prison. They talked about controlling the crime problem, homicide records every year, this kind of thing. So it's a nuanced problem, although it's certainly true that now that white people are being affected, seems to me that there is a movement to change the approach to people now understand how a felony record will mangle a young person's life forever. You know, you can't get an apartment, you can't get a job. It's a devastating thing to have a felony record. There is, however, that very, very important difference between these two epidemics. I don't know. I can tell you this. I doubt that we would be talking treatment today if, along with this heroin opiate/opiate epidemic, there came a surge, a mighty surge in violence, the kind of we saw during the crack.
Why is there no violence? Is it because the doctors who prescribe these drugs don't have turf wars with other doctors and start shooting one another?
Yes, I think that's part of it. This is the first epidemic of drug, it was called a drug scourge, that did not start with street mafias, did not start with street traffickers or drug dealers or what have you. Starts with doctors and pharmaceutical companies, really pharmaceutical companies and pain specialists promoting the idea back in the 90s, this was a good while ago now, that these narcotic painkillers were non-addictive, that one used to treat pain. That's one thing they pushed. The more dangerous corollary, actually, in my opinion, is that therefore it doesn't matter how many of these pills you prescribe. That's when we really got into trouble. So if they're not addictive, what does it matter if you give someone 5 or 50? And it turns out it did matter quite a bit, that was the crucial thing. And for 2 decades now, we have been massively overprescribing these pills for all manner of pain, in particular acute post-surgical pain, I would say.
Yeah, let me ask you about the violence, because obviously,
sure,
I would assume that there are a couple of makers of Oxycontin and other...
No, there's only one.
The opiates, I'm sorry. There are a couple of...
Oh, yeah, sure.
Right. Uh-huh. And they're not going to get into a turf war. But they are cracking down on prescriptions, which means, as you said to me the last time you were here, that a lot of these people are now having to get heroin. Isn't there violence associated with heroin dealers?
There's never been a whole lot of violence associated with heroin. I mean, to some degree in some parts of the country, sure, but nothing remotely close to what the crack epidemic created. So no, there is at times. I think by and large, it's a lot. I think drug trafficking on the street has kind of changed to a certain degree, that people know that you just can't have these very public gun battles of the kind I personally covered when I was in Stockton, and it happened across the country as well. And between gangs, that this creates an enormous amount of public outcry and therefore police attention. I think there's a kind of a feeling like we're not, you know, that doing this out in the open the way we used to, it was really the very public nature of the crack epidemic that was the problem. That's what blighted neighborhoods. That's what invited drive-by shootings and tit-for-tat killings and all that. It was very public. This has been indoors. It's been very private. It's been a thing that took place off the streets. And again, a lot of it starts with the doctors. But then also, if you were buying heroin, there's not the open-air drug bazaars. For me, that's what really created the problems with crack. You had
crack houses,
robberies, crack houses, but also, well, I'll tell you, in Stockton, where I lived during all this, there was long streets where there would be several crack dealers posting up and selling all day long. And then, of course, those kind of morphed into street gangs, depending on which areas, the Bloods or the Crips or whatever it happened to be. But it was very public, and that was crack. Crack was out in the open. It was in a rental apartment that you didn't rent immediately. Very quickly got taken over by crack users, and then you had a real problem on your hands. You know, it was all of that very public nature of it. The fact that you're posting up means a guy can come and rob you, and then you shoot him, and then he shoots you. I mean, that kind of chaos and madness took place almost daily in several parts of Stockton.
If you wanted to get heroin, if I decided to go out and get heroin, the cliche is you would drive up to Harlem or to the Bronx and find somebody.
Don't know where you would find it in New York. Sure, you could find it there, but I think you could also find it. My understanding of New York, which is very limited, is that it's now entirely a Dominican, almost entirely a Dominican controlled drug trade. That maybe I'll happily stand aside if some cop or somebody wants to correct me on that. If you, without knowing anything about the heroin world, without being a part of it, wanted to go find, I suppose you would find it difficult. But that's the difference. I mean, the folks who, by the time they've been using for a while, have developed friends in quotations and lots of connections, they very easily can find this. And remember, heroin is a perfect, heroin would not, should not exist. It has no medicinal benefit. that other opiates don't have in greater amounts. And it's got far higher risk of addiction because it, like crack, it gets you high and brings you down very quickly, up and down within a couple hours. So like with crack, you need to use heroin several times a day, unlike methadone, which you use once a day. Heroin should not exist. It exists because of drug traffickers, or the underworld. They found it to be a perfect product. Mm-hmm. It was cheap to make, easy to conceal, easy to cut, and it created customers who had to come to you every day of the year, sometimes 3-4 times a day. That is why heroin exists. And so the market for heroin is it's kind of among people who know where to get it. Just walking out of your house, you alone, maybe in some cities you would know where to go. I think in most places you actually have to kind of be a part of that world. Again, it's not an out, you know, on the street kind of thing. It's a kind of it's a cloistered environment, I think, is where you find this now.
Okay, so the government has been aware. We've been aware of the doctors overprescribing these opiates for a couple of years now. I know that the government is capable of accomplishing some stuff, especially with Obama running the DEA mm-hmm. and the FDA. I would assume right now the problem is more of a heroin epidemic than one of doctors overprescribing. Is that a fair state?
To my way of thinking, I think there's still a lot of overprescribing going on. There's still a lot of scamming off of Medicaid and Medicare. Part of the problem with Medicaid is that it can be easily used as well to scam lots and lots of pills, which I write about in my book. It's very, very graphically. You can, if you can find a willing doc, sometimes you can go to that doctor and that doctor will write you a long prescription for pills you don't need. And you pay a $3 copay and you take it to a pharmacist and you get it all for $3 and you can use it all or sell it for thousands of dollars. That is part of the problem, too.
Everybody was amazed that Bill Cosby could get his hands on Quaaludes because Quaaludes were taken off the market because they had no medicinal right. value other than helping people like me lose their virginity.
Mm-hmm.
These opioids are still being prescribed by doctors. Is that sure. because the drug makers, the pharmaceuticals, are encouraging? Are they fighting the DEA? Are they fighting the FDA? Are they fighting the American people?
No. They are still being prescribed because they're very effective drugs for some things. For example, after a surgery, you would be in excruciating pain if you didn't have these drugs available you've been cut open.
Not that many people are getting surgery.
Oh, no, you're talking millions of people a year. You're talking appendix operations. You're talking shoulder surgery, a variety of surgeries. The difference is how these drugs are used, are prescribed. They have a very, very good use for a certain confined window of time after a surgery, let's say. Say 2-4 days. The problem was, as I said earlier, people were prescribing these drugs as if they were non-addictive. So they were prescribing 30 days at a time, 30 days worth of pills for a pain that would last 2-4 days at the very most. And so a lot of those pills were ending up in the black market. That still happens in some areas. In some areas, it doesn't. It just depends. And some doctors have really cut back, others not. And some places, addicts I've talked to have even gone in for surgery and been told, you need these. They tell them, I'm not taking those pills. I cannot. I'm recovering from addiction. Please, no. The nurse will push these pills because this is part of the culture. It's a. You're thinking there's some kind of like bogeyman behind all this. I think it's far more nuanced. It's a big culture that is created by the pharmaceutical companies, pain specialists, and frankly, Americans themselves. That says it's okay to prescribe these. This is the way we treat pain. We don't have a whole lot of tools for treating pain, and therefore this already has been going on for 20 plus years. It's taught in medical schools. That it's difficult to change. That a whole bunch of people have believed or have acted in this way for most of their medical careers. And at the same time, it's also very important to understand we Americans wanted that. We demanded easy, quick solutions to our pains. We wanted more pills than we probably could needed just to make sure we never felt any pain at all. This was a time, remember, in the 90s, I think you could pretty much measure this almost, where we really came to believe that there was no, we should be allowed we're entitled to a life free of pain. We wanted the doctors to fix our pain. We didn't want to be accountable for our own wellness. We didn't want to be accountable for better consumer and health choices. That is all a big part. Doctors were not the only ones in this game. They were being pushed from a variety of sides, and one place they were being heavily pushed was from us, the American health consumers.
Right. That's a little bit blaming the victim. Last time you were on the show, you really did a great job pointing out that there are two types of dealers. There's the heroin dealer, and then there are the pharmaceutical companies. The pharmaceutical companies, from what I understand from our last conversation, they're the gateway to heroin addiction, because once you get on these pills and you need that same feeling, you turn to heroin. Who is doing better, the heroin cartels or the pharmaceutical cartels?
Oh,
from
I'd say
this?
They're both doing remarkably well.
Give me a name of a pharmaceutical company that produces some of these drugs.
Purdue Pharma is the one that does OxyContin. They're magnificently well-heeled these days. The Sackler family is one of the wealthiest families in America now because of OxyContin.
It's the Sackler family?
Right. So, there were three Sackler brothers. One of them was extraordinarily important for the story, died in 87 before OxyContin came out. But his importance to the story was that he was really the inventor of modern pharmaceutical company marketing. He understood the importance of meeting with a doctor face-to-face, regular meetings with sales reps and docs all the time. And that's how OxyContin was promoted, that very personal meeting, lunch, offer, you know, pens. It's talking with a doc today. He says, you would be surprised what the research shows about the effectiveness of giving somebody a pen and how that kind of will get them to think of you as the person on your side. And that's a good person. And it's amazing how that worked. But they also gave away trips to Scottsdale and variety of other things. This was all, that's part of the larger story to this. A very complicated story, how we got to where
we are. And that's in Dreamland. That's in Dreamland.
It's all in Dreamland. Yep.
It's all in Dreamland. And you would say that the Sackler family pretends it's concerned about OxyContin addiction when in fact they're doing very well from it.
They are doing extraordinarily well from it.
We've been talking with Sam Quinones. He's the author of Dreamland, which is a great book. Everybody should buy it. It tells the story of America's addiction to opiates. And you've been on both sides of the battle in Mexico, here in the United States. Before the interview started, I was warning you that I was going to play devil's advocate, and you got really angry.
Uh-huh.
You almost canceled the interview, because you thought I was going to trivialize this addiction in this country. When you started talking about the 90s, when Americans said, hey, we should be impervious to pain, we should have pills, and it's the victim's fault that we're all addicted to drugs. When I read about, and you can get angry and then we can finish it and hopefully you'll come back and thank you for your time. When I read about this drug addiction, I know it's real. I know that it's the leading cause of death among Americans under the age of 50. My instinct tells me there's a bigger problem at play, that this is a symptom of a sick and diseased culture. Not to trivialize, because I don't want to get you angry, but not to trivialize these deaths. It's serious. Do you think it's simply that we can't handle pain, or is there some macro problem?
You need to read my book.
Yes.
I really seriously do. Okay. You really, really need to read the book. I spent years on this story, drawing out the very complicated story that got us here. And you're trying to make it simple. And it's not simple. Mm-hmm. There's a whole bunch of actors that are part of this story. Okay.
Right.
Now, but that's certainly part of it. Absolutely. Yeah. We got to a point in America where a lot of us just wanted to be accountable for our own illness, wanted doctors to take care of whatever pain we had. That is certainly part of it. But that is, that's the book is very, very clear on the complex factors that are all involved here. All right. It's not one thing. I'm not a believer in the bogeyman theory of history where you can point to the bad guy and say, that's a problem. That's Hollywood. That's a, you know, kind of cartoon. That's right. Not what real life is about. So, no. Answer your question.
Sam Quinones is the author of Dreamland, The True Tale of America's Opiate Epidemic. Thank you for your time. And everybody should go out and buy this book. Thank you, sir.
My pleasure. Thanks a lot.
Okay. Bye-bye. Bye. You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.